Like many other aspects of society, marketing has changed over time. Cutting-edge technologies are changing how organizations connect with consumers. But it's not just about technology. There is also the human side of marketing and how consumers have changed over time themselves. All of this is reshaping the landscape as we know it. So joining me to discuss the future of marketing is McCrindle's marketing executive, Luke Davies. Luke, welcome back to the Future Report podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Good to be back.
Not your first time. You have been on before on the Getting in the Head of Gen Z episode. So very exciting to have you back. No one greater positioned in the team to talk about the future of marketing than the one who looks after all of our marketing. So very
Makes
excited
sense.
To have you. Luke, we talk a lot in the office about business books. We've got, you know, a little bit of a bookshelf here in the studio, out in the main section of the office. We love to encourage people within the team to read business books, inspirational books, you know, different life stories. Sometimes we chat around the office about what we've been reading. And so I'm curious, Luke, have you been reading anything that you might think, you know, is of interest to our audience lately?
Yes. I'm a big fan of business books. And it sounds like a very niche topic, but there are so many of them. And I think, yes, big fan. The one I have been rereading recently, I read it a few years ago, and then I don't know why I reread it. I've just felt like rereading it. It's called Shoe Dog by Phil Knight. He's the founder of Nike. I think the reason was I made a list of books that had shaped me, and that was one of them, especially when I was like back studying business. You can like study business, but reading the stories of people that have built businesses was equally as like inspiring and important. It's just a cool story of the windy road of business. And also, like a lot of these business books, it takes these big CEOs and owners of companies and makes them seem like real, well, they are real people from very normal backgrounds. And there's something I like about that. It encourages me to strive for those things because they started off just as normally as the rest of us. So, yeah.
Yeah, I haven't read it yet, but I know that you've talked about it before. And we were talking about it recently in the office, even with the recent movie that's come out called Air. And there's a lot of, you know, there is Ben Affleck, I think he plays Phil Knight.
Yeah.
And it's just a really interesting story. So I'm like, got to get my hands on that one because I know that you've recommended it, which is cool.
Yeah. And it's interesting because that in the book he talks about, the movie Air is about the Michael Jordan deal. Mm-hmm. And in the book, it's like a tiny sliver. It may be like half of a chapter because the book is done by years. And it's so interesting that they made a whole movie about just that one deal, let alone like the off spin. Mm. So anyway, both are great.
It's a really great book to be talking about, even in the context of this episode, because if you think about really big brands who do marketing well, I think a lot of people would think of Nike how well they have place their products and, you know, sold them. And even when I was prepping this episode, you know, marketing and sales, they're easy terms, but they're almost a little bit jargony as well. Like it's a very business term. You're like marketing. And when I was younger, I was like, yeah, marketing. I'm like, what is marketing? And I was actually just looking up in prep for this episode, like what marketing defined, and a very simple definition was, you know, well, it says marketing refers to activities a company undertakes to promote the buying or selling of a product or service. Mm. Do you think that's an apt description of what it
I'd
is?
I'd say so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I definitely agree the how jargony and elusive it can seem, but I think that sounds like it's what we try and do here for our marketing. So
yeah, exactly. Yeah. And there's lots of different, you know, ways to do that. Mm. I guess, Luke, you know, you've come into the organization at McCrindle at a time where I feel like, you know, our marketing had gone through a bit of a transformation, as it always is. I feel like it's always evolving for a brand, what their story is, how they communicate that, what methods they deploy. For you and yourself, how do you feel like you keep up with, you know, changing marketing trends? I feel like we're probably a little bit biased here because we literally study trends. So, you know, you can be at the office computer and looking up how marketing's changed, even, you know, for a presentation for a client or, you know, to put in an article rather than, you know, actually thinking about how does this change my day-to-day job. But how do you keep up to date with changing marketing trends?
Great question. When I was doing my business degree I would have graduated a few years ago now. As you say, there were always references to the big consultancy firms. And as you say, at McCrindle, we study trends, and as do other organizations. And they're often seen as the forerunners of marketing trends and the place to go. Now I've been doing marketing and trying to grow a business for the last few years, I've come to learn that these organizations are great at presenting broader trends and ideas and thought leadership. But for me, the people that I draw the most inspiration from and keep up with trends and strategies and ways to move forward from are the people that are doing it every day and talking about it every day. And I often speak to you, Ash, about this, how I keep up with a lot of these people on Twitter. Mm. I would say in the past year, some of my best ideas for how we've grown and promoted things here and there have come from Twitter. And it's like Twitter, podcasts, and books in like that order. Like I might, I'll probably like scroll Twitter every day, and I follow a lot of like kind of the big leaders of like business and commerce and technology. And like I might listen to a podcast like once a week, and then read books as well here and there. So it's probably those three things. Just a few weeks ago, I was listening to a podcast with a guy called Ben Francis, and he's the CEO of the, I guess, sports company, clothing company, Gymshark. And they have probably been around for 10 years now, and they capitalized early on in the e-commerce days. And now they're a major competitor to Nike and Adidas, and they provide a lot of sports and gym clothing for people. And again, the fact that he's probably in his 30s, he's quite a young guy. But on this podcast, he just talks about how he started, how he grew this business, and his relationship with the e-commerce Shopify. And then on Twitter, I follow a few of the guys behind Shopify. And so it's just like this big ecosystem of like top high performing leaders and CEOs that you can very freely glean from. So yeah, it's not one place. It's just the internet is the answer. It's like a mixture of finding the right people in those positions. And yeah, like random founders and investors and venture capitalists who you can learn a lot from.
Mm. And it's interesting that you've commented on that, and it is amazing how much free, amazing insight is on platforms like Twitter, where thought leaders are putting out really concise, easy to absorb, practical tips around marketing or storytelling. So it's really cool that we have that like at our fingertips. Mm. But yeah, it's a great, I think, topic to be, you know, thinking about. And I also think that for me and for you, we'll be in the office talking about how we're going to market something, how we're going to communicate about, you know, a podcast episode or a book or a presentation or a research project that we've just completed. And it's great to also see when you subscribe to different organizations or companies, even like how they market themselves through email, or we sometimes look at examples that are on TikTok, even when we're thinking about, you know, a reel or something a bit more fun or culture that we want to communicate. And then what vehicle, what platform, what story, what almost tactics they're using to deploy. It's just great to see, you know, from the theory and around, you know, podcasts and books, I think, to also then what are organizations doing in practice. And then it's a bit of timing and luck as well, because you might see something that a great organization has done that's yielded great traction, and then, you know, you replicate it and it doesn't work as well. Then you just flick something, you're like, this kind of went viral or got really great returns, or we look at the analytics. So it's a bit of, like anything, a lot of strategy and a little bit of luck probably around what marketing campaigns do well and things like that.
Yeah. And that's the thing with a lot of these people. I was saying earlier how when you read business books, you realize they're very normal people who just created enough opportunities to eventually succeed. And it's the same with us in marketing. We always say that whenever we put out a new email or a reel or like a LinkedIn post, it's not so much about putting all of your money on one post going viral. It's just consistently doing it over time and creating opportunities that eventually something will happen. So
yes, the consistency part is so crucial. Oh, and it's the way less interesting side of marketing or viral, you know, campaigns or trends or whatever it might be. But even the word, you know, viral and using some of this language, digital marketing, it's very easy, I guess, for someone who's been in, say, business for a long time to observe how marketing has changed over time. I mean, even sometimes I reflect when I'm driving on a freeway or something and you see like the big, you know, advertising billboard campaigns, or if you're, I watch, we make a joke sometimes that I'm like a bit older than I, my ways are a bit older than I actually am, you know, I'm watching free to air. And I mean, I stream a lot of content, but sometimes I'll watch a bit of free to air TV and you're sitting there listening to an, you know, an ad or a commercial or something. And, you know, it's those things are still deployed, but there's so much more that happens now around how organizations, you know, can market themselves. And so I think all of us can agree that technology has changed the game with regards to marketing. But I'm keen to hear, Luke, some of your reflections around, I guess, trends that you're noticing when you think about how marketing, you know, has changed or where it's kind of heading.
Yeah. It's interesting. I think for me, I see it a lot from a younger generation point of view. So I could tell you how things are going to change, or like how better to market to like Gen Z. But there's still, and like, I'll get to that, but there's still like the generations above it who have the majority of the wealth in the world and are still like participants in the economy. And so there are the, like the classic things like storytelling and appealing to emotion and like people's deep-seated needs. But I think one of the big trends that I'll talk about, especially among Gen Z, is that authenticity. And it's interesting. I was thinking about this on the weekend. In, if you watch like any sales video or sales course, they always say that people buy from people, not brands. And especially in the work that we do at McCrindle, all of our services are quite bespoke, and you have to come to one of our team to engage our services. And you'd think that that would die with the rise of digital marketing and digital avenues. But there are so many examples of people on like on TikTok or even through email marketing, how you can put that personality forward. There's a brand on TikTok that sell like swimwear, like swimsuits. And it's just like these people who show their audience what's going on in their factory and their warehouse. And it's just like, it sounds so uninteresting, but because it's the behind the scenes and you see these people's personality and how they interact with each other, there's a very human element to that. And again, I would vouch that people who buy from them are buying because of the people, not necessarily because of the product. I assume the product's great. Like, I'm sure it's great quality. But yet again, I think that's a great example of how, yeah, one of the big trends is remaining authentic and being a person that people want to work with and buy from, and appealing to that.
I think it's a really important point to make, because we so often talk about the emerging generations in the future, and we do wholeheartedly believe that they're important, and an important consumer to be thinking about and evolving strategies for. But then we also don't want to forget about like the one of the largest generations who, like you said, have got the most purchasing power still. They hold a lot of the wealth, being the baby boomers and even the Gen Xers. So important to think about how different generations respond to different marketing. But in terms of that evolving and authenticity, it's really interesting. One of the, I guess, influences that I was thinking about when we were preparing for this episode was the Inspired Unemployed. Yes. And we've talked about them a little bit in the office, and I've heard other podcasts talk about them as a bit of a case study as to how marketing and influence has really shifted even to that more real, authentic, less polished advertising campaign in a studio, but it's like homegrown, you know, with an iPhone set up on a tripod or something. And even like big brands are putting money into those sorts of like grassroots influencers. And so then it's also interesting, even that whole social media influence world, where now you've got to specify if it's a paid ad, because it does look so like this is what me, not that I'm an influencer, but if for an example, like me, Ashley Fell, I love this product. And the people that follow me, you know, might be like, oh, Ash loves that. But if I'm being paid, that makes this weird tension of like, well, how do I know exactly? So it's interesting to see how that's evolved. But even like we have this slide that we sometimes present around how marketing's evolving, and it was, you know, peer influence in the past, which is still important today. You know, you take a recommendation from someone that you trust on a product or something like that, or a service. And then today it's very much the influencer culture. And even in the future, it could be more that artificial intelligence, which we already start to see even come through social media. And even some of those ads that are on Instagram, for example, like this, it's every second kind of scroll. And sometimes they're so well hidden that you're oh, it's an ad. I didn't even realize.
Those are very creative.
They are a bit sneaky.
Very well done. But those are the people that have managed to understand what people are looking for on the platform instead of just slapping on an ad that is so blatantly trying to sell something. It's the people that can fly under the radar, and it may be set up as an ad, but if it looks like something you'd normally be scrolling for, it's very, very well done. And you're right with the whole authenticity and the inspired unemployed, how it's a very grassroots approach. It actually feels it feels so backwards to be putting out content that isn't directly trying to sell anything, but you're just trying to build an audience and a voice that eventually has like a call to action, which is like the point of which someone would purchase something. And it almost goes against a lot of things that people have always been told about marketing, like there should always be a next step, and the next step is to buy, to inquire, to join a list, to make an inquiry, whatever. And you're right, it feels very backwards, but that's something that's become really important because people value authenticity in branding.
And like if people have seen the Inspired Unemployed, it's very much leaning into the Aussie bogan, like they are unashamedly. And I think Aussies are just getting around it because we've seen these, again, like this real polished kind of perception of something promoted and marketed, and now it is that swing back to authenticity. But then you get like, I'm pretty sure, you know, I'm saying this on a public platform, don't quote me on it, but I'm pretty sure there was like some pretty big brands that they worked with, like Louis Vuitton or something, like this luxe brand that then is partnering with this grassroots influencers to reach a demographic that, like, they've got millions of followers, you know? So it's just interesting. Like you said, it's not backwards, but it's reshaping the trend or the trajectory that maybe, you know, marketing was on, which is fascinating to watch and observe.
There's another one. I forget. I don't know what the podcast's called, but tapping into that Aussie bogan approach, it's literally, it's a beer brand. They're selling like a craft beer, and it's just two blokes on two different couches with a setup like this. And people call in and just tell stories, and it's just like builders and tradies, and they'll just have a good 5-minute yarn with a cracker story. And the whole time they'll just be like the beer cans in the front. And like, maybe I think there's an ad at the beginning of the podcast, but again, there's all of their content is just people being people telling their stories, but behind it is this beer brand. And it's hilarious. Like, they've done such a good job promoting it.
And I think what that example makes me also think about how powerful it is when a brand or people create a community around a brand.
Yeah, absolutely.
And the podcast is almost like, podcasts are this, I've heard it, you know, a meme about it where it's like you're overhearing a conversation, like people listening, you know, between friends or between colleagues, in this case, colleagues and friends, in terms of, you know, people listening. But when it's heaps more story based like that, you know, you get people connected into that community around, and then there's like you said, that logical next step where it's like, you know, you've like, they would wear maybe the beer branded merch or something because they want people to know that they're plugged into that community, which is centered around, say, a product or something. So yeah, it's interesting that whole creating a community around a brand, which is not like so many people put real strategy and thought into, but it can be hard to do that authentically when there is so much strategy involved. So people who do it well, you know, we admire them.
Organically building community around a brand is like, it's very bit, impressive.
And it's a bit like, not ironic, but it's almost like we're authentically building something. Like, it's not genuinely happening organically if you've got the end goal to sell a product.
Sell products.
It doesn't mean it's wrong, but anyway, interesting.
But that's where it's important that, and again, I think we've seen this in our research, more and more people don't just work for a paycheck. They work because they value the work they're doing and they aligned with the brand that they work with. Like, that was the reason I wanted to come and work at McCrindle, is because I had read a few books about the power of using data to inform decisions. And I was really inspired by that and thought, oh, it would be really cool to be involved with that. The same with Nike. Phil Knight talks about how one of his first salespeople was just this crazy guy who loved running and just wanted to sell running shoes and wanted nothing else in life. And this guy, Phil Knight, sent him to open the shop in LA, like a storefront. And I think the guy slept in the office because he couldn't afford to rent an apartment. But he just never complained because he just loved running, like loved track and field and loved what they were doing. So when you say, yeah, it is backward to build a community around a brand, I think that authenticity comes through and people genuinely love what they're doing. Like these guys who are promoting the beer brand on a podcast, it's probably because they genuinely just like love people and love a chat and love the stories that people have to tell. So, and it comes through, it's organic. So we see that more and more, that value alignment with what people do for work.
Yes, totally. And we have this slide that we sometimes share in our presentations, which is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So at the bottom and the base of the pyramid, you've got survival, and then the next layer is security, then social, then self-esteem, then self-actualization. And we often talk about, like, if we expand the pyramid out, this kind of timeless piece of psychology and, you know, the way humans behave, if we apply that to, say, like a consumer situation, at the bottom you've got questions like, what's the warranty of this product? You know, can I return it? Is this well priced? What's the guarantee? What if it breaks? And those things are still important in a consumer transaction. But what we're seeing, especially among younger generations now, is a shift towards those higher order drivers. Like, is this brand for me? Do I identify with this? And you can apply that to the same, like an employee situation. Like, is this organization that I'm going to be involved with, like, for me? Do I identify with the purpose and the values? How will this make me look? And I think that's really important, even when people choose to wear, say, merch or buy from an organization, and we're in this really social world, whether it's sharing something on Be Real or Instagram or TikTok or, you know, Snapchat, if it's the brand product there, like, what does this brand stand for? And people are going to be like, Ash, why are you buying from that brand? They're not ethical, or, you know, and then I'm like, all of a sudden that's reflection on me. And even those higher order drivers, like, what about the environment? What's the contribution? What are the values? So yeah, exactly like you said, Luke, there's a lot more that goes into a consumer decision these days, and what's the community around the organization, the brand, rather than just like, what's this product? Is it well priced? Do I like it? You know, will it benefit my life? Like, there's other things that go on in that transaction, which is interesting. And I think that does relate to something else we often talk about with regards to consumers, and it's what we call expectation inflation, which is this idea that in this hyper-connected world we're living in, where, you know, we're used to scrolling on our social media feeds, where everything is really visual and short and sharp and engaging. Even your point, like, it was interesting to hear you say it's Twitter and then podcasts and then books, like, from short form to long form content. Like, if I'm going to engage in the book, you've probably read a fair bit about it, or the main points, before you choose to invest X amount of hours actually going to the depths of the content through the book. But it's that idea that we all live in a society that we're driven by constant connectivity, shorter attention spans, instant gratification, which makes marketing things a lot harder. Like, we've got even less time now to capture people's attention. Even as a communicator, like, on a stage, I'm like, I've got like 30 seconds to hook the audience before they zone out or they get out the ultimate distraction device with their phone, you know. So anyone who's got something important to communicate, it's got to work really hard. How do you, I guess, that would be something, I guess, that you would consider when we're putting out content, right? You would be thinking about the audience, because thinking about the audience is a really important part of any sort of communication, I would say.
It's interesting you say that, because on one hand, absolutely, as ever, even something I expect this would have been taught 10, 20 years ago, that the importance of capturing people early and getting a hook. And if you're whatever your storytelling is, having that like really solid first sentence paragraph that brings people in. And we absolutely, yeah, we do that with everything from like subject lines and pre-header text and emails to tweets, and how we get like that first line, how we capture people. And even with like, if we're making TikToks and reels, having, I mean, those are short anyway, like it's not just about the start, the whole thing has to be like less than 7 seconds.
That's right.
But interestingly, as I think about it, there's also, yes, people's attention spans are becoming shorter, but I think there's still a lot of value in having long form content that really has meat to it and sustenance to it.
Yeah.
And so at McCrindle, we a few times, probably 4 or 5 times a year, we'll have an hour long virtual presentation where we'll have insights on whatever topic or industry, and then we'll have 30 minutes of breakout sessions. That's an hour and a half. And, you know, that's not just a short amount of time for anyone's workday. Even our articles that we write, they are snappy and to the point, but we do put a lot in there, and we flesh out a story, and we include stats, and we make sure it's written well and has length to it. So I think, yeah, whilst we use a lot of techniques and strategies to hook people in, we do also value long form content that has sustenance to it. Even if you read any of our client commissioned reports, they can be anywhere from like 20 to 60 pages. That isn't like short content. Now, obviously that was commissioned work. That's not a marketing piece that we needed to snap someone up with. But yeah, I think there's a value to having knowledge of how to kind of get people's attention quick, but being substantive, that you actually have meat and sustenance to what you have to say and what you are presenting people.
Yeah, it reminds me of a couple of things. I think it's a really great point, like you mentioned, and it's almost that idea of there's a trend and there's like a counter trend. Like, yes, short form is important, and yes, it's crucial. And it reminds me of, I guess, what we talk about a lot, which is repurposing content, that idea that we might have like the Generation Alpha book, then you've got like a masterclass video, then you've got an infographic, then you've got a tweet storm. Like, it's almost like the same, not the same content, but summaries of different content, and you want people to engage with that almost short form, and then intrigues them enough to go, well, what's the next step? Like, what's, I want to find out more. And the same with you, I think, with like, you might read a tweet storm and mark someone, and then you go, oh, they're an author. Okay, well, before I buy the book, I might listen to the free podcast. And then that convinces you. And then you go, okay, I'm bought into this. Like, I want to be part of this and learn from them. So that's really important. But also, I think what you're talking about, like the substance is key. And I think for us, because we work with a lot of organizations, and part of our product offering, like what we're marketing, is our research services. And we see in this world of kind of fake news and ambiguity around truth, like the importance of research, and even the importance of having substance behind, say, a PR campaign. Like, if an organization wants to be a thought leader in something, research can help them to become that, because they've asked people, they've got hard facts and data that, you know, you can't argue with, rather than just, this is the best product ever, you should engage with us because we think this. It's more thinking about the consumer side. And we've gone on that journey too. Like, I've been at McCrindle for a long time. I feel like I was probably the marketing person for a long time. And then we've grown, we've got more sophisticated. And even like, I'll write something and you're like, hey, Ash, you know, we need to write this, you know, in the perspective of the audience, rather than we are this, we're doing this, you know. So there's so many things. But yeah, I totally agree in terms of what you're saying around substance is important, even though, like, to hook them, you've got to do that really quick. And even we often talk about subject lines and like, you know, how we write them, like almost clickbaity, so that people actually get to the substance part.
Yes. Yeah. So. And it's definitely a fine line. As a research company, we have a level of professionalism. So it can't just be sloppy clickbait.
Yeah,
but we also want to capture the attention of people. So yeah, we walk that line.
That's a really great tension as well. Because I guess we never want to be seen as saying, oh, it's just about grabbing attention, so drop the facts and drop the truth, you know, that no, those things are still definitely important, the substance. I think as well, something I reflect on about marketing and how it's changed and what I've read is, even, you know, technological change and new platforms impacting how organizations market themselves. And I mean, immediately I think about what we've already spoken about around, you know, social media and how that's changed people's expectations, and that we're so used to scrolling. And if something doesn't capture, we scroll really quickly. Like, organizations have got to work hard to capture attention and then maintain it. But also more the strategic side of marketing, like the back end, like the platforms that we use around, you know, like gathering data about consumers, or even like around this podcast, like what episodes are getting good listens. Okay, what topics? Let's investigate that. Let's push into that. Even that idea that it's not even around, like, I mean, what you have to say around marketing is important, but also like the data gathering is really important. Would you agree with that, Luke?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. And is that it? Like, discuss the like impact of data and how we gather that. Because yeah, it's not just important, but it's also never been as accessible as it now is.
Absolutely.
And I don't think we appreciate how much is already done for us. Like, when I think of like all of our social media analytics, you literally just have to post stuff and it will just collect data for you that you can view at any time. Mm-hmm. Or we'll send an email campaign and it's just already collecting data for you. Like, it's never been as accessible as it is now, which is amazing. And a lot of these platforms, you know, you might put some money into starting up with it, or, you know, if you're running ads, you put some money into it, but generally have such a high return on investment for what you're putting in. You know, it used to be that you'd have to pay to put an ad in a newspaper or a billboard with a very limited idea of how many people saw it. You know, maybe they said, oh, we have 10,000 people purchase our newspaper every day, so maybe that number of people will see your ad. Now you can, I mean, you can post on social media for free and get analytics from it, or you can pay to put it as an ad, and the, like, you'll get the breakdown of country, the like where these people work, the age range. Like, you have so much collection of insight into where it's going, which is like invaluable to help like define your persona and understand who and what your content is clicking with.
Yeah, I think about our marketing meetings that we have, and there's a few of us that are involved in that, and we almost always start with the analytics and the data, and we look at, okay, what's resonating with our audience, what's got good traction, because that then drives strategic decisions about what we choose to push or promote. So you're right, almost that needs to come first. And like you said, it's just never been more accessible. Like, even on, like, if you, I think there's a setting on Instagram that you can become like a creator, and then you can get analytics on the content that you're doing straight away. Like, it's never been more accessible. So that's great. I think for organizations, they don't have to, and so much of it is free. It's built into these platforms.
It doesn't even, as I think about it now, I think when I first got into marketing, and I think I used to get quite caught up in the micro numbers and looking at it every day. And I think, say you're a solo business owner and you're trying to run a shop whilst running like the online store as well as fulfilling customer orders, you may think, when am I ever going to get time to look at my analytics and stats? At McCrindle, we do a big monthly look at how we've gone in the past month, just compare that to kind of the rolling months, like how we look a month on month and compare it to last year. That's probably, I think that meeting is like an hour, but say if you're a solo business owner, if you just did that once a month for 20 minutes, you would have such a great understanding of how your business is tracking, what are the trends. And that's where data is very powerful, is when you look at the trends over time in that kind of like meta narrative sense, when you zoom out. If you look at it every day, that's not going to mean too much. You know, in particular situations it does, but I think for us and the size we are, looking at sales or leads every month really helps us to gauge how things are flowing, and it can be really encouraging as well. Like, some day on day it might go up and down, but if you are running a business, and you're sure, there might month on month there might be ups and downs, but hopefully things are trending up. And all that to say, there can be a lot of numbers and a lot of like fogginess in all of it, but if you just took 20 minutes once a month to look at it, you'll probably find a lot of clarity and insight in just that.
Yeah, it's crucial, I think, for sort of marketing in today's world, and easier than ever, which is very encouraging to very, you know, like busy people and business owners. Yeah. It can be a bit like the barrier to entry is very low in terms of you're not like, oh, I have to like make a big Excel spreadsheet and a dashboard. Often these platforms just have those. Like accessible. So
yeah, definitely.
It's good. I feel like we've talked a lot in almost every question or topic within this podcast, like the word storytelling has come out. And I love, even if I'm ever doing like a consumer of the future presentation or a mark or communication strategy workshop or something, I often include this quote from Seth Godin, who's a bit of a marketing sort of thought leader, who said, marketing is no longer about the stuff that you make, but about the stories that you tell, which I think is quite an interesting shift in some ways, because even that definition of, you know, marketing about promoting the product, it's more in, it's less about the product and more about the strategy or how you communicate something in today's world, where the power is really with the consumer. Like you said, we're not kind of passive consumers reading newspapers or looking at advertisements or having to sit through an ad in the middle of a TV show. It's very empowered now, I think. Yeah. And so I'd be keen to hear from you, Luke, just around your thoughts on the importance of storytelling when it comes to, you know, marketing in the future. Do you think it will still remain that sort of timeless, important component?
It's interesting you said that, oftentimes, what was it, Seth's quote, it's not about the product you make, but the story you tell.
That you tell,
And it's also in line with that whole thing of you're also selling a lifestyle these days. You're selling status a lot of the times. And like as you were saying, with a brand, does it have like an environmental aspect? Does it like it's a given that the product works and is functional? But are there environmental considerations, social considerations? Does it like promote my lifestyle or, you know, my status and bolster that? And I just thinking about it now, it's probably only because we have the internet that, you know, maybe 100 years ago, I would only know the people on my street in my town. And that's the only people I had to compare my life to. But today I have the joy of comparing my life to the world's biggest CEOs and, you know, marketing gurus and venture capitalists and whatever. And so who I associate with becomes all the more important to promote myself in this as a global citizen, not just a citizen of my little street in that has no like connection to the outside world. Anyway, that's just a side thought. But yeah, on the topic of storytelling, that's absolutely. Like I'm a huge movie fan. I'd say it's a hobby, just watching movies. I do other things, but I'm a big fan of movies, and I've definitely always connected with that storytelling aspect of things. And again, it comes back to understanding your audience and being passionate about what you're selling so that you can actually connect with people in their story. That's why we love movies, is because we often identify with one of the characters or a particular theme in the story that we feel seen, and like we feel like we're not alone in the world when we see other people relating to it. So hopefully at McCrindle, when we put out content that helps people feel seen and spoken to about the importance of using data to make better decisions, we hope that that connects to them because we know the power of it, and therefore they're interested in engaging our services so that we can help with that. And think about it again, Nike are also very good at that. They have so many cool, I think they're quite renowned for their advertising, of, you know, it's things like, this is for the, like, for when the 5 a.m. alarm goes off. Like every runner would understand that feeling of like being able to wake up at 5 a.m. to go for a run. And even Phil Knight in his book, I think he starts out the book talking about that, like that feeling of there being no one else in the world awake in like the crisp cold mornings in Seattle, which is where he's from. And it was like the entire business flew from that passion of his, and all through storytelling of connecting with people. So
we do a lot around storytelling. Here we try to model it, and you do an exceptional job of that through our marketing, and even just the importance, like you said, of making something aspirational and having an emotional connection to something, and you know, that idea that they're selling more than just the, way more than just the product. It's lifestyle, it's aspiration, And you think about the big brands who've done that so well. Nike, Apple is another one that kind of transformed even, like, they had a functional computer, but they made it so aesthetic and everyone's lining up. And you're like, well, how do they get people to do that? How do they get people to want this product so much that they would stand in those cold mornings and wait around the corner for it? So it's interesting to look at some of those really successful case studies. And Nike's absolutely one of them too. So
yeah. And it's even, I think it's easier for people who work in marketing if you approach it not from, and this is where you have to, like, I understand in marketing, you have to play the short game of, like, you have to make money today, but playing the long game of what if after my time or my whole career or life, I can help to immortalize companies through the marketing that we did, and that you capture the story of the business and you capture the story of what it stands for. Even at McCrindle, the way we would make like reels and videos, a lot of the time we're just kind of capturing and immortalizing what, who we are and what we do. Mm. And imagine in 10 years time, we look back and it's captured the essence of what we're about and what we're passionate about. Mm-hmm. I think if you can do that, that takes a lot of pressure off just trying to make money and sell a product, but more like a passion product of like, you're almost a journalist in that sense, in that you capture what was happening on the ground at a particular time, which, and that sounds like a cool opportunity to me.
Yeah, you've really, I think, sold the marketing field to our listeners. You've marketed the field of marketing very well.
Marketing, yeah.
Very meta. It's been such a joy to have you on the podcast, Luke. So many great examples, tidbits of wisdom and insight and gold. So thank you very much for your time today.
Thanks, Ash. Appreciate it.
And if you would like to stay up to date with some of the marketing that Luke and the team are putting out from McCrindle and our latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media where we post some of those aforementioned reels and polls and things. And you can also head to McCrindle.com to find out a bunch of information there. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.